If you guys want to hear more from me, make sure you check out my new podcast, the Jordan Theresa podcast, available on YouTube, Apple, and Spotify.
Hello, everybody. I hope you're all well. So the other day I was scrolling through TikTok, as per usual, filling the silence of my life with any source of entertainment so I don't have to have a single original thought of my own. And I found a TikTok from the user at Good Morning Pooter, which reads, "I feel like we'll look back on this era of excessive skincare hoarding, how we look at the 2010s era of makeup hoarding. Girlies having IKEA closets full of makeup they weren't going to be able to use before it expired. 7 different blushes, 10 different mascaras. When will we release ourselves from the shackles of consumerism?" Now, I'm not on skincare TikTok myself, but one thing I was I was obsessed with beauty gurus when I was younger, and I very vividly remember watching lots of different makeup collection videos. They were my favorite videos to watch ever. I grew up in the 2010s, and for a good, I'd probably say over 5 years, I was watching nothing but beauty gurus. I wanted to be a beauty guru myself, and from this TikTok, I decided to do some reminiscing myself and decided to rewatch a load of old makeup collection videos from specifically the early 2010s, and it was even more excessive and ridiculous than I remember it being. The 2010s makeup collections was just a seed in my brain, and then my thoughts just grew from there. Someone stop her, she's thinking. So today I want to talk about 2010s consumerisms and these ridiculous makeup collections and post 9/11 consumerism, and also what the original poster of that TikTok was talking about, whether mostly women's overconsumption has shifted from makeup to skincare and the rise of clean skin makeup on TikTok. And just before I get into it, I would like to thank today's sponsor, Ren. They very kindly decided to sponsor another video of mine. I'm so happy to be working with them. I loved working with them on my last video. All of us know about the climate crisis and global warming, and that it's very anxiety inducing, and that, you know, it's very unsettling to be sort of living in these times. And obviously we do need to be looking at the super rich CEOs and factory owners who are causing so much of this pollution, but also it wouldn't hurt us to take a look at ourselves, and we can make small different changes in our lifestyles to reduce our carbon footprint. And this is where Ren come in. If you don't know what Ren are, they are a website which helps calculate your carbon footprint and then offset it by funding all sorts of different carbon reduction projects, such as anything from tree planting to rainforest protection. So how it works, it's very, very simple. You just go on the Ren website, answer a few lifestyle questions. Ren will calculate your carbon footprint and give you all sorts of different tips and tricks on how to reduce it. And you have the option to contribute monthly to Ren, and Ren will send you monthly updates, pictures, details of all the different projects you support.
Another Ren project which really stood out to me was the biochar in California project, which helps prevent California wildfires by removing flammable dead wood from California's forest to stop wildfires. And not only that, but they turned that wood into biochar, a stable form of carbon that persists for thousands of years. The reason why this project really stood out to me was because I kind of had no idea that there was such a environmentally friendly way to reduce wildfires and turn the cut down trees into a stable form of carbon. I thought that was really cool.
Obviously, it's going to take so much to end the climate crisis. I'm more than aware of this. I'm sure we're all aware of it, but we can still make small changes as individuals to our lifestyles. So if you would like to offset your carbon footprint using Ren, make sure you click my link in the description. And Ren, very kindly, with the first 100 people who sign up using my link, will have 10 extra trees planted in their name, which I thought was so, so cool. Make sure you guys go and click the link in the description, and thank you so much, Ren, for sponsoring today's video. Before we take a look at some actual makeup collections in the 2010s, first of all, let's talk about the beauty trends of the 2010s. As you guys know, I love reminiscing on this channel. My 2010s fashion trends video was one of the most fun videos and most cringeworthy videos I I've ever filmed, but I loved every second. And also, some of you guys are really young who watch my channel and weren't, I mean, you were around in the 2010s, but you may not remember as vividly as I did the beauty trends of the 2010s. So guys, feel free to use the comment section as a collective cringe space. So just a brief rundown on the beauty trends. First of all, we had very full coverage matte foundation, and all of the contouring was done using a lighter concealer and a cream bronzer slash contour shade, and also very heavy on the powder, particularly baking. I'm still not anti-baking. I know a lot of people don't like baking, as in baking with makeup, not baking cakes. But the worst makeup trend of all, and I'm sure anyone who did this themselves can look back and just look back in horror. Heavy highlighter. Like, I am talking heavy, bright white highlighter on the apples of your cheeks. And I'm not anti-highlighter. I love highlighter on my nose. I love highlighter on my cheeks too. But Jaclyn Hill, I don't think I'm ever gonna forgive you for your crimes. And the fact that you made me walk out there with a strip of white highlighter on my face. And I thought it looked good. In the early 2010s, really bushy brows were super like in trend. Like, it was a very big thing. Cara Delevingne was very much like the model of the moment. What was very interesting was seeing how the natural bushy brow trend evolved. Eventually, with enough makeup and evolution, the bushy brow trend ended up evolving into the 2016 Instagram brow, which was sort of powder but ombre at the tip and then carved out like literally to perfection with concealer. People love to shit on this brow trend now that feathered brows are really trendy. I don't get why everyone shits on it. When it comes to eyeshadow, the early 2010s can only be defined with Urban Decay Naked palettes before they decide to absolutely drive that trend into the ground. And also the Too Faced chocolate bar palettes and the peach palettes, which used to smell like chocolate and peach. But like, one standout eye makeup trend, which I think everyone on TikTok always talks about because it was just like everywhere, was really warm orange eyeshadow, like really warm orange smoky eyes with like a nice shimmery orange color. That Morphe 35O palette was a cultural reset. And one thing I found looking back on pictures was that 2016 eye makeup, like that sort of smoky orange eye makeup with very sort of thick winged eyeliner, I'm saying that as if I don't have really thick winged eyeliner on right now. Let me explain. It didn't cater to everyone's eye shape very well. Like, now I feel like there's such an emphasis on making sure that your lid is clean and just doing the wing outside of your eyeline. People didn't used to cater to their eye shape that often. So 2016 eye makeup tended to look quite heavy on a lot of people, including myself, because no one really knew how to cater to their eye shape unless they had really round eyes and a lot of lid space. But one trend in the later 2010s, which I really liked, and I probably really like this because I could never do it myself, and that's cut creases. Not that many people do cut creases anymore. There's such an emphasis on sort of like fox eye makeup that people don't want to go too heavy on their eyes anymore, but I still love them. But one beauty trend, which I actually think is on par, if not worse than the heavy stripe of Jaclyn Hill highlighter, was liquid lipsticks. Now, for some reason, in the 2010s, like 2016 to 2019 maybe, was someone somewhere decided that having to reapply your lipstick, it's just such an inconvenience. Why would anybody want to reapply their lipstick? So liquid lipsticks were invented for the sole purpose of it staying on your lips all night. And usually liquid lipsticks, like the Kylie lip kits, came with like lip liners as well to go with it. And liquid lipsticks, they look amazing on application, and they especially look amazing if you have, and I'm not trying to read anyone here, if you have overfilled lips. And I'm not shitting on lip filler. You guys know I've got lip filler myself. But if you have very overfilled lips, liquid lipsticks will look amazing on your lips because your lips are overfilled and the skin is stretched so much. The liquid lipstick doesn't have any creases to sink into. But if you have just moderately lip-filled lips, or you just have your natural lips, you're fucked. They would sink into the cracks so badly. They would actually age your lips and you'd look like an 80-year-old woman just here. So they dry down, but they dry down to all I can describe as a dusty texture. All of the makeup girlies, which is me included, were going through it in 2016. We were going through it. They would dry down to a chalk-like texture, and then they would just flake off throughout the day. And then if you reapplied it on your already very dry, dusty, chalky lips, the sort of dead skin, you can tell that I know this from experience, the dead skin would like clag up, and then you'd start dragging your dead skin all around your lips when reapplying the liquid lipstick, and then it would be dragging the dead skin all around your lips, and then the dead skin would get on the liquid lipstick applicator. It was just bad for everyone involved. It wasn't bad for Kylie Jenner though. She got a fat check from those liquid lipsticks. And this very full coverage glam makeup, in my opinion, from what I saw on social media, was very much the beauty standard at the time. All of the sort of sounds really cringy coming out of my mouth, but all of the Instagram baddies had this kind of very full coverage, full glam makeup. And I think the reason why this makeup specifically was so popular with Instagram influencers and Instagram baddies and beauty gurus was because technically it's photograph makeup. It's photo makeup. It's photogenic makeup. A lot of beauty gurus, I'm not sure whether it applies now because I don't really watch any beauty gurus, but a lot of beauty gurus in sort of the 2010s, especially the mid-2010s when everyone started stepping their pussy up and buying ring lights, everyone used very harsh, very heavy studio lighting. And in my experience from using a DSLR, using a ring light and a DSLR, it tends to sort of smooth your skin so you can't really see where your makeup looks super cakey. And not only that, but using a very bright studio light, like a ring light or maybe even soft boxes or both, it tends to wash you out and it tends to wash out your makeup. So you have to apply even more of it for it to show up on camera. Makeup which looks amazing on a DSLR camera with a ring light directly behind it, like that really nice stripe of highlighter on the apples of your cheeks, that fresh liquid lipstick, that really full coverage matte foundation looks amazing on camera, but it may not translate all the same in real life. And the same with Instagram influencers, a lot of them did and still do now use Facetune and smooth their pictures, so you couldn't really see how maybe cakey the makeup looked in real life. I feel bad for like dissing people's makeup when I'm sat with possibly the worst makeup I've done in my life right now. This makeup's been on my face since 9 a.m. Now, let's talk about the makeup collections, what I've been so excited to talk about in this whole video. Strap in, you guys, it's reminiscing time. So every makeup collection featured some kind of IKEA Alex drawer and usually a set of Muji clear drawers on the top. I had a set of Muji clear drawers. That's how I kept all of my makeup in 2010. And all of these huge IKEA Alex drawers are filled to the brim with makeup. Foundations, concealers, blushes, powders, eyeshadow palettes, the list goes on. I remember I was watching a makeup collection video from Emily Noel, and I feel quite shady for saying this because I think this makeup collection was from like 2016, so it wasn't even that long ago, but she had an entire drawer just full of eyeliner. Like, I'm talking, there was hundreds of eyeliners in there. You wouldn't even have enough eyeballs or days in the year to use that many eyeliners before they dry up and before they expire, because you don't want to use expired or dried up eyeliner on your eyes. You might get pink eye. And I just want to make it clear that I'm not like trying to dig out anyone in this video, actually. I'm not trying to dig out Emily Noel for owning a ridiculous amount of eyeliners, nor anyone who owned excessive amounts of makeup in the 2010s. And beauty gurus who owned excessive amount of makeup in the 2010s. Because first of all, I owned an excessive amount of makeup in the 2010s. I had every single Urban Decay Naked palette, even though I never used to use them. Wearing and owning a lot of makeup in the 2010s was just what was popular at the time. And no one really had any sort of conversations surrounding sustainability, minimalism, over consumerism at all in the 2010s. 2010s. And there are many reasons why people owned such ridiculous amounts of makeup in the early 2000s. The first one and the most obvious one being consumerism. Products are shoved down our throats all the time, whether it's in advertising, whether it's seeing celebrities living extremely lavish lifestyles and feeling envious of it. To put it very simply, when something is put in your face enough, you'll either want it or your brain will think that you need it and that it will make you happy. But as we all know, happiness from buying material goods is always very short-lived. For example, you wanted this Dior blusher, which Kylie Jenner's makeup artist apparently uses on her, and you've wanted it for weeks, and it's been sold out for ages, and suddenly it comes back into stock. You buy it straight away because you don't want it to get sold out. It arrives, it's in its really luxurious Dior packaging. You wear it for the first time, and you pop it in its makeup bag, and then that's it. You feel sort of that rush of happiness when it arrives and when you unpack it and when you use it for the first time, but eventually, because it's in your makeup bag and you're using it every day, it gets old and you find a different makeup product to want and to lust after and to buy. And then the cycle just continues because the happiness of buying something is so, so short-lived. But also there are other reasons to explain excessive makeup consumerism of the early 2010s. And don't get me wrong, consumerism is basically the main reason. But there are sort of other little small, I don't know, I guess I've been thinking of theories. There are sort of other things which I've theorized as to why people owned so much makeup in the 2010s. And I thought of two reasons apart from sort of the wider issue of consumerism. First one is the collectability aspect. And the second one is the content creating aspect. Makeup collecting was huge in the 2010s. People used to dedicate entire rooms to store their makeup and to do their makeup. And people really took pride in how their makeup collections looked. They would store the most expensive, luxurious, high-end products on the top of their Alex IKEA drawers or on their vanity, you know, those gold YSL lipsticks or that giant Chanel cream bronzer, which is actually really good. I've used that before, it's good. And people also used to buy a lot of limited edition makeup. MAC limited edition collections really stand out to me. And people wouldn't necessarily buy the limited edition collections because they thought that they really liked the shades or they thought they would get a lot of use out of it. But rather, it was for, first of all, the limited edition packaging was always super cute. And second of all, that collectability aspect of it, like having this limited edition MAC makeup piece that not everyone had, was like very special to a lot of people. And I understand that. Someone who collected makeup myself, I literally used to own like 20 MAC lipsticks and so many of them were like the exact same color. I didn't buy it because I wanted to wear it. I bought it because I wanted to have it so I can have it as part of my collection. Like the Viva Glam lipsticks, I had the Viva Glam, I think I had the Nicki Minaj and the Ariana Grande. It was that collectability aspect of it. It was just having it, you know? I know that sort of collecting makeup can be seen as quite wasteful because eventually it will expire. Is collecting makeup any different from collecting shoes, from collecting designer bags? I want to know what you guys' thoughts are. Because the one thing which I do think that makeup collections differ from sort of any other collections, like people who collect shoes or people who collect like Pokemon cards, is that makeup expires. So eventually it's just going to sit there and be unused and be a waste.
But something which definitely is worth noting is that I'm pretty sure a lot of beauty gurus and makeup YouTubers, because they were sent so much makeup and they had to buy so much makeup because reviewing makeup was their job. I know that a lot of them would give their makeup away to friends and family, like the lightly used and tested makeup, and would also give the lightly used makeup away to women's shelters. I don't know which YouTubers did that, but I remember hearing about YouTubers doing that. So I'm not saying that all of these YouTubers and beauty gurus used to buy a load of makeup and then let it waste away and then throw it in the bin. That definitely sort of wasn't the case for quite a lot of them.
And when it comes to content creating, at the end of the day, these beauty gurus who had like excessive amounts of makeup and the most ridiculous makeup collections. It was their job to review makeup. They'd get sent a lot of PR, and any makeup which they did buy could be written off as a business expense. So it was very much like a win-win situation for them. And something which I have actually noticed watching YouTube videos for like 10 years of my life is there definitely has been a shift in sort of like YouTube culture. And that shift is, I think now more than ever, personality is everything. In the 2010s, and I'm not digging at anyone, I'm not shading anyone, being a YouTuber and especially a beauty guru was a lot more about what you had rather than your personality. And don't get me wrong, it's not like I think that 2010s beauty gurus are like super unentertaining or boring. Being a beauty YouTuber was a lot more about what you had. If you wanted to film a different makeup tutorial every 3 days, you'd have to own loads of different makeup. If you wanted to review a brand new makeup collection, you would have to buy the entire collection. The most popular videos of the 2010s were haul videos, what's in my bag, room tours, monthly favorites. Sorry, petition to bring back monthly favorites videos. Those were great. And all of those videos, yeah, sure, you have to have a likable personality to be successful on YouTube, but all of those videos were basically about what you had and your belongings and what you owned and what you were buying. Ugh, no! I rent this flat and I hate this sofa. So I try to cover it in lovely pink blankets like all the time, but especially when I'm filming. But now I'm so exhausted and it's freezing. I think I'm just gonna wrap myself up in a blanket. So I hope you guys don't mind. One second. So excuse the fact that I look like I'm ready to tell an old wives tale, but don't get me wrong. You still need to have like some kind of a personality for me to sit through your 30 minute Sephora haul. But it was a lot more about what you had rather than your personality. Now, there's been a shift, and I think the app to blame for that shift, guess what app I'm gonna say, is TikTok. I think that TikTok filled a short content market which had not been filled by any app before. If you wanted to find out whether to buy the new Fenty Beauty foundation, instead of having to sit through someone's 15 minute review, you could actually search up the foundation on TikTok and watch a load of 1 minute reviews easily. People no longer have to sit through a 15 minute review of one makeup product. They can just go on TikTok. So now, people only really watch YouTubers if they really like them as people. Obviously, buying and owning a lot of material goods does definitely contribute and help with YouTube success. But I definitely think people now more than ever come back for people's personalities when watching YouTube videos. But anyways, back onto the beauty standards chat. Most of us know that beauty standards sort of work like a pendulum. Is that the word? Like a sliding scale. It always seems to go from one extreme to the other. So a very common example is in the early 2000s, the beauty standard was to be extremely skinny with big fake boobs and basically no butt. Then in sort of the mid-2010s, the beauty standard was having a really hourglass body and a BBL. In the 90s, it was very popular to have thin brows, and in the beginning of the 2010s, thick bushy brows were in trend. And something which I've noticed, and I could be wrong here, but I find that almost like the more unique something is, not necessarily something which is out of the norm, something which still sort of fits into beauty standards, but the more unique something is, the more desired it becomes. So when it comes to changes in makeup styles and sort of beauty standards in relation to makeup, and again, I could be chatting out of my ass here, but I have a theory. In the early 2000s and the early 2010s, full glam makeup wasn't readily available to everyone. First of all, drugstore makeup was not of the best quality. If you wanted to have really good quality makeup, you'd have to spend quite a chunk of money on it. But unless you actually were a professional makeup artist yourself, it was very difficult to teach yourself the skills of how to do full glam, almost sort of professional makeup. You know, it takes a lot of skill to do full glam makeup without looking like an absolute clown. But then there was a rise of in-depth makeup tutorials from people who are either really, really good at makeup or were actual professional makeup artists. And not only that, there started to be more affordable, high quality makeup products for people to use to follow these really in-depth makeup tutorials. You know, affordable brands started producing really high quality products. A real game changer was those those Morphe 35 shade palettes. Before then, the only sort of really big eyeshadow palettes which you could buy were those Coastal Scents ones, which had like the layers, and they like felt like chalk and they smelt like kids' makeup. But anyways, I keep getting sidetracked with 2010s makeup nostalgia. But now that there were so many in-depth makeup tutorials and there was also affordable high quality makeup, full glam makeup became a lot more readily available to the average person. You didn't have to be a makeup artist to reach this standard of beauty anymore. But just before we discuss what happened after everyone learned how to do full glam makeup and the shift in beauty standards, let's talk about another reason why these beauty gurus may own excessive amounts of makeup, something which I researched, which I found super interesting and I wanted to share with you guys, and it is post 9/11 consumerism. On September 11th, 2001, two planes hijacked by terrorists flew into both of the Twin Towers. People in the planes died, people working in the buildings died, firefighters died, and even people who had survived the attacks would die years later of illnesses related to dust exposure. 9/11 left America as a whole traumatized, and politicians began to worry that life would not return to normal. Americans would be spending less money, which would push America into a recession, and people would start losing their jobs. And what is worse than a country going through a national tragedy? A country going through a national tragedy and a recession. So pretty quickly after 9/11, politicians started stressing to the public that the way to move past this tragedy and to overcome it was to spend money and reinvigorate the American economy. As you guys can probably imagine, American airline companies took a pretty big hit during this time because no one wanted to get on an airplane. And the president at the time, George Bush, urged Americans to take their families to Disney World, Florida to help the country's airlines, and that the American economy was still very much open for business and that you should take your families and enjoy life the way we want it to be enjoyed. Vice President Dick Cheney also stressed that the public should stick their thumb in the eye of the terrorists by not letting what happened in any way throw them off their normal level of activity. And after 9/11, very weirdly, a lot of companies decided to cash in on the tragedy, and there was a spike of American flag themed merchandise. Anything from American flag clothing, shoes, prom dresses, even nappies. And some companies even offered to donate the proceeds to some of these American flag themed products to an assortment of 9/11 charities, and never did. And during a national crisis as tragic as 9/11, citizens are going to want to be proactive and want to do something to help. Helping your country in a crisis is like the peak of patriotism. And what's the easiest way to help your country? Buy loads of things and keep the economy running. By buying stuff, you are keeping America out of a recession and you are stopping Americans from losing their jobs. And placing the responsibility of keeping the economy running on citizens is not anything new. I'm sure we all remember the pandemic because it's still going on. I remember in the first lockdown, we obviously couldn't go out and eat in restaurants, we couldn't go traveling. So we were urged by the government to order takeaway from local restaurants and to pre-book holidays for next year. And by doing this, we were doing our part. And on top of this, companies were reassuring their customers that they were there for them. And I even saw some companies offering discount codes during the first lockdown. And look, I don't think that voting with your dollar, as people call it, is always a bad thing. I think in the pandemic, a lot of people decided to shop from small businesses. But what I'm trying to stress when I'm talking about post 9/11 consumerism was how consumerism was rebranded as a patriotic, selfless act, a good deed. And don't get me wrong, patriotic consumerism is not anything new. There was an increase in American themed, you know, red, white, and blue patriotic products during the Gulf War. But the post 9/11 sort of patriotic consumerism, I think, sort of set the tone for the next 10 or 15 years. Because I know that some of you guys are probably thinking, oh, well, these beauty gurus owned excessive and ridiculous amounts of makeup in 2012, which was over 10 years after after 9/11. Well, I think despite 9/11 happening over 10 years ago at that time, I do think that consumerism and buying things and even buying things in excess was still seen as a good thing. People still weren't being very critical of overconsumption. Consuming and buying, even in excess, was still seen as a good thing. I mean, I'm sure you guys can remember in haul videos in the 2010s, beauty gurus and lifestyle YouTubers saying, oh, well, I didn't need this, but it's good for the economy.
But this is a real find.
Just buy it. You don't have to rationalize everything.
All right, I will buy it. It'll be good for the economy.
It wasn't until at least the mid-2010s that people started being more critical of overconsumption, and that there were conversations surrounding overconsumption. There was a lot more of an emphasis on minimalism and sustainability. As we discussed earlier, 2016 to 2018 was really the peak of full glam makeup. There were all these different affordable, high-quality products available. There were loads of in-depth makeup tutorials showing you how to create these elaborate, gorgeous, full coverage glam makeup looks step by step. And a lot more people started doing glam makeup. And as most of us know, as soon as a lot of people start conforming to a beauty standard, it changes. And in 2020, I definitely saw that with the rise of clean makeup. Clean makeup, also known as off-duty model makeup, can be defined with dewy skin, foundation that looks like skin, cream or liquid blushes, glowy but still very natural highlighter, feathered brows, long fluttery eyelashes, very natural eyeshadow, like just a little bit of highlighter or bronzer, and a tinted lip balm or lip oil. And it seems that one of the most important parts of this makeup trend is having naturally very clear and glowing and dewy skin. And don't get me wrong, heavy makeup is still pretty popular. There's definitely been a rise of e-girl makeup, which is inspired by anime. I still wear very heavy makeup. And I know it seems ridiculous to be having discourse about a makeup trend, but I have so many thoughts on it. I don't think it's a coincidence that clean skin makeup has risen in popularity alongside sustainability, minimalism, wellness, and self-care. But also, I think that clean makeup, for me, represents how astronomically high beauty standards are now. 6 years ago, the beauty standards were to use a lot of makeup to make yourself look pretty. And now the beauty standard is you're expected to look extremely pretty very naturally, and your makeup is meant to look like you're not wearing that much makeup. I feel like a hater for getting a little bit pissed off about clean makeup. And I just want to make it clear, there's nothing wrong with minimal makeup, and there's nothing problematic about slicking back your hair. Clean makeup isn't about wearing minimal makeup, it's about looking like a fucking supermodel.
Interjecting once again to say that I don't think that people who do clean skin makeup are trying to look like supermodels or anything like that, and I don't think that you need to look like a supermodel to pull off clean skin makeup. I think it's just something I've noticed where, but something I've noticed is that the focus of clean skin makeup isn't necessarily the makeup, and rather it is looking perfect.
The clean makeup trend was very much inspired by supermodels, Gigi and Bella Hadid, Kendall Jenner, Lily Rose Depp, all these people who are naturally extremely beautiful and conform to the ridiculous beauty standards now. And maybe my feelings are almost a bit like emphasized when talking about this, because like I'm getting a little bit vulnerable here, but this trend is something which really highlights my insecurities, because I just don't feel like I suit natural makeup. I don't feel like I have a very feminine face, which is okay. I'm not that fussed about it. I just feel like the beauty standard at the moment is just being naturally beautiful, which just like, and I don't think that anyone who joins in with this trend is like internally misogynistic, but I don't know. It just feels a bit internally misogynistic, doesn't it? Like the emphasis that looking clean is wearing barely any makeup and slicking back your hair and having clear skin. But back onto the topic at hand, what spurred this whole like thought process in my head in the the first place was that TikTok and how people are maybe over-consuming skincare products similarly to how people were over-consuming makeup. People are buying loads and loads of different expensive skincare products to try and fit this new standard of beauty. And I just sort of wanted to explore, is consuming excessive amounts of skincare in 2022 the same as consuming excessive amounts of makeup in 2016? And to be honest, I don't really know, because on one hand, I don't think we're ever gonna see people who have as excessive amounts of skincare as people had as excessive amounts of makeup, if that sentence makes sense. Like, I don't think someone is gonna have an entire IKEA Alex drawer just full of skincare, like one entire drawer full of eye creams, which they'll never use before they expire. But also, I think collecting skincare and buying maybe too much skincare can tend to be a bit more wasteful than buying too much makeup, because I don't know about you guys, I don't particularly look at makeup expiry dates. I very, very rarely look at makeup expiry dates unless it's going like directly onto my skin, like a primer or a foundation, maybe even a concealer. But I've been using the same eyeshadow palette since like 2019. The only time I'll really stop using a makeup product is if it dries up. But skincare expiry dates are a lot more important, because this shit is seeping into your pores, okay? And the entire purpose of skincare is to get like clear, glowing skin. So you're not gonna risk it by using an expired product which might make you break out. But I also think the way that skincare is marketed, I think that people are less likely to be self-critical if they are buying too much, are less likely to be aware or be conscious of them possibly over-consuming, because skincare is marketed as a form of self-care. And it's not like I don't think skincare is a form of self-care. I think anything that makes you feel good, as long as it's not like dangerous, can be considered a form of self-care. And I'm not trying to cancel skincare. I'm not saying that skincare is problematic. You know what? This entire video has actually been propaganda to stop you guys from buying skincare, because I have really sensitive skin, so I can't buy loads of cool skincare products. Anyways, I'm just saying that if you're looking to buy a skincare product, which you don't necessarily need, think about why you're buying it. Are you buying it because, I know, like, it will make you feel good and it's like a form of self-care, like a nice face mask? Or are you buying it because you want to adhere to beauty standards and you think that's going to make you happy? And look, as women, we're always going to be adhering to beauty standards no matter what. I'm not going to talk about the male gaze, because I've spoken about it 1,000 times on my channel, and I give that gaze, those men and their gazes, I give them far too much attention on here. But I think nothing is worse than when you buy a product and you think that it's going to make you look amazing and that you're going to end up looking like Madison Beer or something. Then you try it out and you don't look anything like Madison Beer, and then you feel really bad about yourself and you feel ugly and then you like cry. I think at the end of the day, we aren't all going to look like Gigi or Bella Hadid or Kendall Jenner or Madison Beer, but also that's okay. Like, we don't have to. And just to finish this video off, to round it off, I've seen some people talking about how women tend to get criticized the most for overconsumption, and is it possibly like a bit misogynistic? And I do kind of know what people mean. I do think that women are very sort of heavily criticized for overconsuming, whether it's fast fashion, whether it's makeup, skincare, blah, blah, blah. And to be honest, let me know if you think I'm wrong. I think that women as a whole are more likely to overconsume things like fast fashion and makeup. And I know that there are men who do also buy makeup and fast fashion, but I think that because women are under such sort of like strict beauty standards, and we're sort of like controlled by beauty standards. Like, beauty standards, they are a capitalist tool at the end of the day. I think because we are so controlled by beauty standards, we are far more likely to overconsume than men. Like, men like overconsume like NFTs. And this isn't necessarily our fault, because at the end of the day, the beauty standards are so unreachable that like, unless we buy 1,000 products, we're like never gonna feel happy. The same way that we think that we'll be happy once we conform to a certain beauty standard is the same way that we think we'll be happy when we buy a certain product, if that makes sense. So for example, you have thin lips, so you want to get a load of lip filler to fit the beauty standard. Once you get that lip filler, you're just going to want to get something else. Once you get your lips filled, you're going to think, oh, why don't I get a nose job? I've got a really big nose, or something like that. You will buy Kylie Jenner's Dior blusher, and then you'll wear it, and then you'll think, you know, this is all right. And then you'll see that Madison Beer is wearing this lip gloss. Oh, but now you must buy this lip gloss, and that's going to make you conform to beauty standards. Because beauty standards are a capitalist tool. As long as we keep chasing them, we're going to keep over-consuming and we're never going to feel happy in ourselves. And unfortunately, it is very hard to not conform to these beauty standards and to not over-consume in order to buy products which will help you fit into a beauty standard. I mean, I'm preaching about beauty standards if I don't get Botox in my forehead and wear a full face of makeup whenever I film a video. But I think something which will make a small difference is if you're just aware of what is driving you to buy different products, different fashion pieces, different makeup products, different skincare products, different hair products. And maybe if you become a little bit more self-critical, we can just consume a bit less. You know, it's a step in the right direction to stop consuming so much stuff, which will just end up in the bin. But yes, I hope that you guys enjoyed this video. Sorry, that was so long it felt like. If you did enjoy it, make sure you give it a thumbs up. But yes, and I'll see you soon for another video. Bye.